repentance and faith, let us confess our sins that still so easily besets us, and receive the full forgiveness our Lord daily provides for us. Have Christ, who once was slain, not burst his three-day prison. Our faith had been in vain, but now has Christ arisen. As your baptized people, Lord, forgive us, renew us, and preserve us in Easter joy. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty, eternal God, in the word of your apostles and prophets, you have proclaimed to us your saving will. Grant us faith to believe your promises, that we may receive eternal salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for God's holy word proclaimed.
The Old Testament reading is from the book of Exodus. The people of Israel set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain, while Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel." So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is from Paul's letter to the Romans. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned, for sin indeed was in the world before the law was given. But sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many die through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Would you please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel? The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 9th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." And he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew his brother. James, the son of Zebedee, and John his brother. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus. Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, "Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you go, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand.' Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You receive without pain, give without pay. Acquire no gold, nor silver, nor copper for your belts, no bag for your journey, nor two tunics, nor sandals, nor a staff, for the laborer deserves his food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy in it, and stay there until you depart. As you enter the house, greet it, and peace return to you. If anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet when you leave that house or town. Truly I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves, so be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say. For what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. We confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. Christians, what do you believe? I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, Light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, I would like to invite our Director of Christian Education, Mr. Yurtford, for our children's message portion of the service.
I'd first like to apologize to those in the live stream. My computer's trying to do updates while we're live streaming, so if you're having technical difficulties, it's not you, it's me. So let me just apologize there first. But for our kids in the back, and we've got a couple over here. Do you
guys know what this is.
What is it?
Yell it.
Yeah, it's a suitcase, right? Anybody going anywhere this summer?
You guys got any plans to leave?
No, Fritz is not. No. Well, if you're leaving, you want to make sure you pack, right? You got to pack for the right amount of days. I'm going to steal this chair.
Excuse me.
But if we were going for like a 3-day weekend, how many pairs of clothes should we grab? Probably 3, or maybe a little bit more. Let's see what Mr. Yurt packed for his 3-day weekend. All right. Let's see. I've got 2 pairs of shorts, so I'm good for like a month, right? We turn them inside out, and we turn them backwards and forwards, and right? We're good. Okay. And then I've got my pajamas, right? Got my shirt. Got my shirts and underwear and, oh, no socks. I have deodorant. You know, it's Florida. We get stinky, right? I've got an extra pair of shoes. I got my flip-flops, my flippy-floppies, so that way if one of them breaks, hopefully these will work for the time being. Let's see. I've got some reading material. I got some books to read in case I get bored wherever we decide to go, which we're not really going anywhere, but, you know, I got some books for it, right? And then, I got some body wash and some shampoo. I got my contact solution. You know what I didn't pack, though? Stuff to brush my teeth. That's at home. Left that in the counter this morning. So, I've got a whole bunch of different things. And it's nice, right? If you go traveling, you got the right amount of clothes, of the right certain clothes. Like, if you're going swimming, you want to have your swimsuit. If you don't have that, it's not as much fun. What if you didn't have your luggage at all, though? Let's say you're gone for a week, and your bag goes missing. Number one, what's going to happen? You're probably going to get stinky, right? It's Florida. Even if you take showers every day, you're wearing the same clothes. Oh, right? It's not as much fun. Well, if you're listening to our reading today that Pastor did, God said, don't take this. He said, don't take any of this. And he said, don't take this either. Don't take your wallet. Don't take your money. Don't take your extra clothes. Don't take your deodorant. We're going to time out, Jesus. It stinks. We're going to smell. No. But if I don't have all of that, who do I have to trust on? Or trust in. You gotta trust in God, right? When Jesus was sending out the disciples, he didn't want them to be set on themselves, be self-sufficient, to have their clothes and be like, all right, I'm good today, I'm looking sharp, I can walk through, I'm smelling great. No. He wanted them to be sufficient on him and him alone. He wanted them to trust him. To provide for everything that they needed. That's why they weren't allowed to have money with them, because they had to earn it. That's why they weren't having extra clothes and everything, because he wanted them to be taken care of by him, by those that they were serving. You either do a good job, and you got people that'll take care of you, or you don't do a good job, and you got to keep on walking. Now, I've lived in California a couple times, Georgia, Illinois, New Orleans, Florida. Do you think God takes care of me as I go to place to place? Yeah. Not always the way I think it's going to happen. I'm not living in like a huge mansion with like 5 cars and a couple wives. No, right? I mean, no. I've got my house. It's not even my house. I had a car that's technically not mine yet because we're paying it off. And I've got people that take care of me. People that show me that God is caring for me because they help me out. They watch me through situations and help to take care of me. That's how God works. When we trust in him, it doesn't work the way we think it's going to, but it works the way that God thinks it's going to. He's taking care of you and he's providing for you. All we have to do is something really tough. Trust him.
As kids, it's maybe a little bit easier. As adults, we suck at it. We're not great. But that's what God asks us to do, is to trust Him over anything else in this world. Would you guys pray with me real quick? Let's go talk to God. Dear Heavenly Father, as you send your disciples out, you send us out.
Help us
to trust in you over ourselves,
over the world,
and over anything the devil says.
Help us, Lord,
to spread your word
that others may trust in you too.
In your name we pray.
Amen.
Thanks, guys.
Over time, you transformed from sloppy civilians to members of a well-oiled military machine, ready to handle any challenge thrown its way. Worthless and weak became effective and strong. And that was because someone who knew made you better than you would have been on your own. Now, many of you can look back on that, whether it's your military training or your education or your vocational training or simple mentor relationships as the reasons for becoming who you are today. In our gospel today, Jesus takes the worthless and the weak and makes them what they never could have been without him in the first place. Now, looking at our gospel, there is an odd conundrum that doesn't come across clearly in most English translations today. When our translation says, healing every disease, I prefer the rendering, healing the unhealthy. Unhealthy encapsulates so much more than disease does and grasps the sense of what Jesus actually said much better. Now, that can include many things that people do that decrease their physical well-being, but has nothing to do with invasive disease we often have no control over. Like willfully drinking our livers into a pickled state, spousal abuse, child abuse that makes the home hellish for everyone, and gluttony that puts our bodies at risk for early onset heart disease and diabetes, just to name a few. I don't know if you caught the report this week, but in Wuhan, China, there was a gentleman that's been in constant quarantine that has gained 246 pounds. It can be a real health risk. Also in our text today, when our translation says, every affliction, I prefer every infirmity. Now, the word for infirmity can be traced throughout Scripture and is used in a variety of ways that far exceeds translating it as affliction. Matthew 11:8 and 1 Corinthians 6:9 are a couple of good examples. Jesus uses the form of this word as saw. What did you go out to see? A man dressed in soft clothing? Now, in Jesus' day, men who were aspiring to be popular spiritual leaders donned the comfortable, soft clothing of the royal courts rather than the scratchy camel hair coat that John the Baptist wore in the Gospel of Matthew. They found their riches, their adoring fans, their ivory towers, but became gods unto themselves rather than lifting up Jesus, whom they chose to lift up and crucify on a cross instead. Now, they too could and would be healed, but living to one's own glory at the expense of God is an infirmity that can and will kill the most promising of spiritual leaders. In 1 Corinthians 6:9, it uses it this way. Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality and femininity. Now, certainly infirmity means homosexuality as well, but it means even more. Everyone who finds the flexibility to wander from God's ordained family designations also finds themselves spiritually infirm. Jesus can and will heal them too. But when Christ refers to their infirmity, he is not only talking about their clothing or sexuality, but their flexibility with their faith that leads to denying their Lord Jesus. Now, it's nearly impossible for any language to accurately summarize all the amazing things God says to us. But each time we pour ourselves into our Savior's world, He opens yet another chapter of the good and gracious acts he desires to do on our behalf. And Jesus shows just how good and gracious he is when he sees the crowds today in our lesson. He feels compassion for them right in the very hardest of his emotional seat. Like when we watch those commercials with the abused animals, or worse yet, starving children with distended bellies holding containers of meager portions of food and dusty, dry dirt. On the one hand, we all feel that kick to the gut when we want to do something about it until that image is replaced by another image that helps us forget we saw it at all. Jesus, on the other hand, never forgets, and his compassion is without end. Jesus knows their condition like only God can, and he knows how to help them like only God would. He knows their worries, the pressures they feel, the challenges they are faced with, and most of all, the pain they have suffered. Life without loved ones because of an unforeseen death. Jesus lost loved ones too, and wept openly in grief for them. Poverty, homelessness, and persecution for righteousness. Well, Jesus never owned a thing save the clothes on his back. Foxes had holes and the birds of the air had nests, but the Son of Man had no place to lay his head, and no figure in history was ever crucified for the lack of sin. He also knows their sinful compulsions, whether cast down from drunkenness or addiction to the choice vices of their day. Jesus knew whatever poor choices they made, and he alone could redeem them from the mistakes they made. The attacks they faced that left them as good as dead on the roadside, whether caused by the occupying government, temple guards, the puppet king henchmen, Jesus saw it all. He cared about it. In fact, he cared so much, he did something about it. By providing an eternal kingdom the world could never provide, and paid for every inch of that eternal real estate with his precious blood. He had so many to care for, and his work was just beginning to take shape. Oh, shape of things these days, right? I mean, it's easy to see it as dismal, but may I, for just a moment, reveal God's hand at work in the midst of it all? Instead of the pain in your joints as the ever-present reminder of the imminent demise we're all looking forward to, can we rather see it as God's reminder that the day is fast approaching when we will never feel pain again, in a place in perfect peace with our Savior Jesus? Instead of looking at what we lost with COVID-19, could we list the unbelievable, impossible technology gains we have made in a matter of weeks that were on a 5 to 10 year plan to begin with? The lessons we have learned, the communities brought together, the new people that joined us, the new world for Jesus' sake the Holy Spirit enabled us to create. So much by force of circumstances that would never have occurred because we wanted them to. Instead of looking at the church universal in decline, seeing it as mission opportunities increasing. After all, Jesus did. With just 12 members of his church, whilst being persecuted, harassed, and constantly rejected by synagogue authorities, wherever they went, Jesus saw and inspired those few followers to share his truth with the world. And he did it all by dying for unhealthy, infirm, flexible, knocked down by life, and themselves sinners, who had no one to shepherd them and feed them, just like us. So Jesus fed them, and Jesus feeds us too. He started with the broken house of Israel by letting his body be broken on the cross with our sins so he could build us a strong home with the sinner saints he saved in the church for us to flee our crumbling homes of selfishness. And he did it for everyone. Every sickly, unhealable, demon-possessed, and even spiritually dead individual. Because his way could never be our infirm way. His way was the firm, spiritually healthy, absolute way of truth. It's the only way we need to redeem this awful world today. Amen. Now to that peace that surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus always. Amen. In addition to our prayers listed today, we are also adding Kirsten and Nancy. This is Jackie's family that both managed to break their ankles on the same week. Go figure that one out, right? So they're both resting with their feet up, and very graciously still said they'd take my dog in while Marcy never got this week. So that was really cool. So they're looking after our dog while Marcy and I and Matthew fly up to Nebraska. If you had not heard or did not get the word, Marcy's father, Claire, passed away on Thursday morning, peacefully at rest with Shirley holding his hand. We just cannot be more grateful for his passing. We cannot be more grateful for his peaceful rest in Jesus. And we're going to go up and celebrate his life of faith this week with family back in Nebraska. We are also keeping in prayers Ken, who we believe had a stroke. We don't know for sure, but we think that he may have had a stroke. This is Kim Bierlein's family. And then we're also adding Tim back to prayers, who just recently got a major kidney transplant. He's been in some pain, and we're hopeful that they'll be able to address his pain issues. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we offer before you our humble prayer for the well-being of your church throughout the world. Guide and govern it by your Holy Spirit, that all who profess themselves Christians be led into the way of truth and hold the Christian faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in the righteousness of life. Lord, in your mercy, send down upon all ministers of the gospel and upon the congregations committed to the care the helpful spirit of your grace, that they please you in all things. Lord, in your mercy, behold in mercy all who are in authority over us. Supply them with your blessing, that they be inclined to your will and walk according to your commandments. Lord, in your mercy, we humbly ask your abiding presence in every situation, that you make known your ways among us. Preserve those who travel. Satisfy the wants of your creatures, and help those who call upon you in any need, that they have patience in the midst of suffering, and according to your will, be released from their afflictions, including Mel, Letitia, Brenda, Kirsten, Nancy, Ken, Donna, Tim, Dana, Rebecca, Wendy, Diana, Pastor Larry, and Bob. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Father, your dear Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, rose victorious over death and the grave. We remember with thanksgiving all your servants who trusted in Christ and now stand in your nearer presence, where all sorrows are turned to joy. Strengthen us in the confident hope of the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come, that we await with joy our reunion in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. we continue with our hymn on Eagle's Wing, I invite the elder to bring forth the offerings, please. Please rise and join with me for the sacrament and the preface to Holy Communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in the remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in the remembrance of me. Peeling the plastic mylar off the top, take and eat the body of Christ given for you. cup a quick shake, pulling back the foil. Take a drink. The blood of Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Amen. Depart in his peace. Amen. Christo Braggio brought up an idea that I completely did not think about, and I'm very grateful for his thoughts on that, that the children have not been getting their baptismal blessings because they can't come up and receive that from pastors. So now I would like the children to receive their baptismal blessings. Now the Lord bless you as he continues to bless you through the waters of holy baptism and preserve you steadfast unto life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fountain, and the source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Announcements, and we will get you on to your afternoon activities. First things first, I just want to just kind of point out a couple of local celebrities in the congregation with us today. Jay, you mind standing up real quick, letting everybody know you're here? It's always nice to have someone from the district staff with us today. Thank you, Jay Wendland, for joining us, our LCEF representative. And then we have our latest called teacher in our midst, Deneen. You mind standing up real quick first, my dear? Thank you. Deneen, our new third grade teacher. Once the paperwork's are all signed and dotted and I'd and everything, we're all good to go. And it's just so awesome bringing on a great friend of Kip and just a wonderful teacher. We're so excited to have you as a part of our team. Experienced, called, ready to roll. Very exciting, very exciting. Let's see here. What am I forgetting? Oh, yeah. June 21st. Does anybody know what's happening June 21st? Oh, yeah, whatever. Yes, it's Father's Day. But there's something. Voters meeting. We have a voters meeting, all right? So we have to replace the roof. We have to borrow the money to do that. And good thing Jay's here, right? And we need, he's our lending guy. And maybe that's why he's here. You here to keep an eye on the vote? I love it. So anyway, we can't do that without your approval. So we are going to have a full, complete, transparent report on everything that's led us to this recommendation that we take out this loan. So please plan being there to vote on that. So we're doing this in good faith in accordance with the Constitution and everything that you've given us to do. Okay? There was something else I'm forgetting.
Bible studies.
Yes, thank you. Obviously, all of you realize that Marcy's father passed away. We are going to be going up for the funeral this week, which means I will not be available for any of the Bible studies that I will normally have started this week. I know we were just getting, where's poor Marty? I know we were just getting ready to start our Monday back together with the seniors on Monday group, which is so much fun and I was so looking forward to. But it's going to be really hard for me to lead that from York, Nebraska. So I will be in a different part of the country and not able to do that. So everything we have planned on starting this week, we are postponing it just 1 week, and then we will start everything the following week in the requisite order that's involved. So no Zoom Bible study on Monday night, the Pericope study, no morning Bible study on Monday morning will be going on, and obviously I will not be at various meetings as well that I know we have scheduled. Hey, I didn't even see Pastor Spaeth there. Hey, Pastor Spaeth. So we have a special guest preacher next week. Pastor Spaeth is going to be bringing the word to us. Very much looking forward to that. Good to have you back here, brother. Glad to see you there. So very exciting times. A lot of great stuff is going on. You guys are doing a really, really good job following the guidelines. We really appreciate that. And I think that that's indicative of why we haven't had too much of the corona infecting our community in particular. And for that, I'm extremely grateful to God that He continues to put that hedge of protection around us and keep us going so we can continue to do our ministry and prepare the kids and prepare everybody for school in the fall, which is really starting to ramp up to look to be a very, very exciting time. And we think we're going to do really, really well this year. And just so excited about the staff that Kip has been able to cobble together with the available people out there. And it's really just going to be absolutely fantastic. Lots of prayers of thanks to God. Please, over and over again, every chance you get, for He's done wonderful things in our community, which we should be so grateful for. Okay? Any other announcements for the good of the church, for the good of the congregation I may be neglecting? Any other announcements for the good of the community I may be neglecting? Seeing none, go in peace, serve the Lord.